The passing scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.
Hello and welcome to the 26th installment of the monthly BCTV program titled The Passing Scene, News and Views. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, co-compiler of the Passing Scene series, 24 volumes of Reading and Berks historical accounts, copiously illustrated. For the record, The Passing Scene, Volume 24, which came out about 3 or 4 weeks ago, copies remain available at the Reading Eagle office, 345 Penn Street in Reading. Any viewer who plans to purchase a copy and has not yet made the move is strongly advised to stop by the Eagle office in the very near future, as they're down to several dozen books. There will be no reprintings, so anyone interested, move now, because once they're gone, they are gone forever. The selling price is $53, tax included. Appearing today with us, Monday, December the 19th, 2016, are Tony Mattassa, a local historian with a strong interest in Robeson Township history. Currently, he is active with the Amity Heritage Society. Beside Tony is Larry Soltys, a local history buff with a long history of collecting Reading area photos and memorabilia. We're pleased to have these two gentlemen with us this evening.
Thanks.
In case viewers are wondering where we've been since our September show, the October program was preempted for BCTV's annual Oktoberfest auction. And last month, yours truly was laid low with the flu and was without any voice whatever for 10 days. That aside, welcome. We have quite a number of slides for you this evening, some pictures. Unfortunately, when we plugged in, it seems to have scrambled them. So this is going to be a real potpourri of the nth. Anyhow, we're going to start out. The Reading Eagle had an idea about promoting the Passing Scene series, and for the Thanksgiving Day parade, they outfitted some people in those sandwich boards with the Passing Scene cover on the front and a pages inside on the back of each person. It was very effective marching down Penn Street. I should comment that this was a real revelation to me. I hadn't been involved with the holiday parade in Reading for a number of years. This year, it was amazing. They had a real crowd, like an old-fashioned crowd, on Penn Street, all the way from 11th down to 2nd. I was astounded. You know, I've been at parades in more recent years, and there'd be a sprinkling of people here and a sprinkling of people there. You had people lined up 3 and 4 deep almost all the way from 11th down to 2nd. It was really like an old-fashioned Reading parade. It was very heartening to see. Now, there are some more photographs in this series of the parade, but they have been scrambled. So let's see what comes next. Oh, well, we're out near Exeter Street, and the old trolley at the trolley barn and the trolley yard. I worked to get that second vehicle on the left-hand side to show up. That's one of the old sweeper. The trolleys removed the snow from the tracks. They had to do that, and they did it in one of two ways. Either they had like a scraper that went along to clear off the tracks, and they also had like a great big brush, like the inside of a Hoover, that went around to get the snow removed. Do you remember any of those, Larry? Were they around in your time?
No, I don't remember.
Don't you remember that?
Nope.
Oh, good heavens.
I think they went out around 1951.
47.
Oh, 47. Yeah. Then I was only 2 years old then.
Well, you wouldn't remember too keenly. Okay, yeah. I remember that one coming up, Schuylkill Avenue. We took the Schuylkill Avenue line. We did, for where I lived, in West Douglas Street across from Bear Park into Penn Street, and that last trolley ran in 1947. But my father used to go crazy when we had snow, because it would fill in the tracks, and you would try to pass the thing, and passing the trolley right down the middle of the street was no easy matter. Sometimes you would slide on the rails themselves. But anyhow, they had the sweeper trolley, and that did operate almost until the very end, as far as I can recall. I remember seeing the sweeper trolley when I was a kid. This appeared on eBay a short time ago, and I never heard of W.O. Miller. It says another solid carload of universal electric washers and dryers. Washers and dryers. For W.O. Miller, 224 North 9th Street, Reading, Distributors. I look at that picture, and I think it was somewhere around 1924. I don't remember that business at all. It's a name that's completely unfamiliar to me. I don't know. He was not in business when I was a kid, so whatever happened to W.O. Miller at 224 North 9th, I don't know. Interesting picture, though. I know that a number of the local dealers used to get carloads of various kinds of things to sell in their stores. There was a big shipment one time of player pianos that came in for Lichty's, the old music store that later evolved into Brown's Music Store on North 8th Street between Penn and Court. Now, this we can sort of relate to, at least I can, looking at the picture. This is one of a series of postcards, a bird's eye view on the circle of the city of Reading. Looking straight ahead, we see what a huge building the old Masonic Temple used to be, the Orpheum. In my time, the Orpheum Theater had evolved into the Plaza Movie Theater, and they also had other kinds of acts there at various times other than movies. Okay. Looking straight ahead, we see part of old St. John's Lutheran Church on the far right. That's what that steeple is sticking up. But of great interest, at least as far as I'm concerned, on the extreme left-hand side in the forefront, you see the back part of the old post office building. One of Reading's, probably one of Reading's most outstanding architecturally designed buildings. It was a handsome structure. And across the street, you have part of the old Berks County Prison. The Berks County, the actual prison part itself, would be part, would, you see half of it on the left-hand side of the screen. On the right-hand side was a place where they manufactured Case, who used to make stained glass windows, was in that building for quite a while. That building was actually built from the wall that used to enclose the prison. What they did was they built behind it, and they built above it, and they knocked holes through the front for entrance. So there were a number of buildings right along right along Washington Street there between 5th and Church, and they were all made from the prison wall. Now, follow that wall. There's I guess it's, it looks brownish on your screen. If you go up to the end of that, to the beginning of Church Street, right on that corner, and people don't realize that, was the first Berks County Courthouse. It was a log building, two stories. What happened was the old courthouse that used to be in Penn Square, but it was there first. After this was too small, and it was really two rooms, one up and one down, county offices were on the second floor, and they had court on the first floor. It was really quite small. So they went over and built the courthouse that we see in old-time pictures right in the center of 5th and Penn, sitting in the square. By the way, when they dug down to put some sewers and pipes in a number of years ago, when they dug down about 6 feet below the surface of Penn Street, they came across the actual floor, the brick floor of the old courthouse. Henry Diener from Why Missing and I went at nighttime out of curiosity. We went down into that hole, and we examined the floor and removed two bricks. The Lebanon Valley Railroad Bridge. When you go across the West Shore Bypass from Glenside, heading over to Penn Street, you would go on on the right-hand side at the edge of that picture, and you go underneath the bridge. During the famous railroad strike, that bridge was, the Lebanon Valley Railroad Bridge, which was wooden originally, believe it or not, was burned, and it was replaced by the bridge that you see there. When you go across the West Shore Bypass from Glenside heading over to Penn Street, and you go beneath the bridge, if you look up as you approach that bridge heading over towards Penn Street, you look up, you can see the abutment for that original bridge that's shown here in this picture. When they built the new bridge, it was widened and realigned somewhat, but that was the old bridge. Now on the right hand side was where the Union Canal ran along the west side of Schuylkill River, and on the right hand side would have been where the Schuylkill Canal, was. When you go across the West Shore Bypass today, you are actually going over the top of what had been the Union Canal's right-of-way. Now this one you might remember, Larry, the old Iron Master. Remember that? Lancaster Avenue.
I shared a meal or two in that place.
Yeah, Alma Strauss did that drawing. It was for a postcard. I remember when they were about ready to tear it down, the owner was a little on the belligerent side. Tad Kastner and I stood on the other side of the street. We were taking pictures, and he came across the street after us. He didn't want us taking any pictures. But luckily, my finger worked faster on the shutter release than his legs did moving him across the street. So I did get quite a number of photographs. But he was very nasty. He was taking a lot of heat for tearing down a landmark to put up what he wanted to put up, of course. Now we have a drugstore on that corner at 1319 Lancaster Avenue.
Was that actually on the corner, or was it up a little bit?
Just a little, yeah.
A little bit up the street.
Yeah. There's a car wash, I think, on the left side of that. I'm not sure whether that's still there or not.
Bear Alignment used to be there, too.
Yeah, Bear Alignment was there. You're right. That was a very old building. It was definitely a landmark. There aren't too many landmarks left, really, on Lancaster Avenue. One by one, they've been disappearing over the years. That should ring a bell. You can see to what degree that's been changed. Notice the old stone pillars that led up to the boulevard that eventually went its way up to the pagoda. The mansion that you see in the far left still stands. The building that you see between the two stone pillars, that still stands. They rebuilt that, or they put a new siding on a number of years ago. It's still an attractive building. But that was a single resident home at one time.
Is that the one they made a bed and breakfast out of?
That's the next one down, I think.
The next one, okay.
I think it's the next one down. Now, this picture was taken in the days before the 13th Street extension. You know, people always say, well, what happens to 13th Street? All of a sudden, you're on Clymer. Well, the answer is that years ago, 13th Street dead-ended right about this site. And it wasn't until the 1950s that they extended 13th Street, cut through that the hillside there, and connected with Clymer Street. So that was originally, you look at old photographs, and you can see that where 13th Street ended, there was like a walking path that took you over to the site that you see here. And because people used to ride their bicycles and walk across there as a shortcut. But in the 50s, they extended 13th Street, and you have there, this was the first slide leading into the Reading section. Surprise, surprise. This was sent to a thinking that would be this would be of interest, and it certainly is. This is the Neversink Mountain Railroad car, and it says George Koch, the motorman. That picture was taken at the summit level. Gloria's great-grandfather, John Brees, was a motorman on the Neversink Mountain line. There's a picture of him down at the Glen Hotel that was made into a postcard. That's a rather rare view. I've never seen that particular one before. So we're at the top of 13th Street, South 13th. You go to the very top. As a matter of fact, a number of years ago, you could still see in the winter, when you had a little sprinkling of snow, the old inclined plane up South 13th Street to the summit level.
As a kid, we used to know that as the motorcycle climb.
It was a motorcycle climb, because they used to test Reading standard motorcycles by going up that hill.
Well, wasn't the Highland House at the top there?
The Highland House burned in 1930. I remember talking to some woman years back who said that as a girl she cried because her mother told her that the hotel on top of the mountain was on fire, and she ran over and the moon was right above the hotel and it looked like the moon was burning. And the little girl was afraid that it would burn the fire would take away the moon.
My grandfather lived on Chapel Terrace, and he watched that fire. It was directly at the end of Chapel Terrace in
1930. Of course, that building closed during Prohibition, supposedly. There was an old joke in East Reading that that building that you saw at the top of the mountain with all the lights on was an abandoned building. It was a speakeasy. It shows how open things were, that you could actually have a light on in every window. And supposedly the hotel closed in 1920, which of course it didn't. This was sent to me, picture taken in 1924. That's the Daniel Boone House, which was earlier owned by the Duterte family. There's a cemetery on that property at the Daniel Boone homestead, and there is a Duterte burial ground there. So they were there at the time that the burials were made. You can see that in 1924, the building needed a bit of work, and that it used to be visited by people who would go in and out and just sort of spook around the place. This again was taken about the same time, and that is what we know today as the Daniel Boone Homestead. Actually, the Daniel Boone Homestead, as we know it today, as we picture it today, was essentially the Duterte farmhouse. The only part of the Daniel Boone home that Daniel Boone would recognize today would be on the far left side, the basement. Everything else was built above and beyond the original portion of the Daniel Boone cabin, which was a small affair. Reminding you folks that we're on live tonight, December the 19th, Wednesday. Our phone number is 610-378-0426. I'm hoping that my voice holds out tonight. I'm beginning to have some problems. Anyhow, this was sent to me recently, and that's the train station at Blandon. I have no recollection of the train station. That's the freight station at Blandon. I know where it sat, but I have no recollection of ever having seen that thing. People who are familiar with Birdsboro, as you go to the south end of Birdsboro along Furnace Road, F.M. Brown's Mill lies on the left-hand side of that road at the far end, and across the tracks would have been this train station. This was the Wilmington and Northern passenger station. It was a handsome building, passenger station at Birdsboro. The agent who operated the facility lived in the second floor. That was typical of a lot of those old stations. They had living accommodations on the second floor, and the first floor was used for passenger and in some cases for freight service. Birdsboro had stations at actually Reading Company, WNN. They actually had
three.
Yeah, well, there are still two stations left. The one freight station, which is sort of abandoned, and the other one was the Penzi station was made into a pizza parlor.
Right.
Pizza parlor. And the old Reading Company one was down near the bridge that was taken away a number of years ago, and this one is gone. So they actually had four. This popped up recently, and I'm not really sure where this was taken. It's identified as bathing in the canal at Birdsboro. Either they're on their knees, or that's deeper than I realized that it was. This picture that popped up a short time ago, I had never seen it before. Bathing in the canal at Birdsboro. This is a neat picture. That was a footbridge across the North Kill Creek in it's at Burnville. That doesn't look terribly sturdy, does it? The North Kill Creek used to parallel the Burnville Road. When they worked on the Blue Marsh Dam project, they realigned the North Kill so that when you see these old pictures of bridges over the North Kill and whatever, dams on there, those are all gone because of the alignment during the Blue Marsh Dam project. That's a very interesting old picture. Gloria tells me we ate there three times. I have no keen recollection of that. That's the Bellevue Diner. The Bellevue Diner would have been at Bellevue Street and Fifth Street Highway.
Quite where Sheets is right now, I think.
And I guess in that general vicinity. I remember being in there one time. This was a picture that I wanted to use a number of times, but they used a photographic process that makes it almost impossible to copy that picture. It picks up a strange pattern, and it looks pixelated to the nth degree. So it's a picture that you can look at on the screen, but if you try to print it out on paper, you're a little disappointed. But that was the Bellevue Diner. This is a mystery to me. what you're looking there, it was labeled the Wummelsdorf Tollgate, and there we see a Wummelsdorf car. The cars that went to Wummelsdorf came out of Reading, crossed the Penn Street Bridge, went through the boroughs, and in Wummelsdorf there was a train barn in the sort of like in the middle of the town. It was somewhat near a building that's where they've been having auctions, or they had auctions in Wummelsdorf. It's on the right-hand side of the main street. Of course, the building is now gone. There were a number of toll houses like that. Some of people will remember, I'm sure, the toll house that was in Sinking Spring. You remember the one that they tore that down in Sinking Spring. I think the one is still standing in Runnersville. There was another one in Wummelsdorf that was taken away. I cannot pin down, I did some deed research on this, trying to pin down exactly where that was and try to get a number, like a street number for that thing, and I just have not been able to pin that down. There was an article in the Reading Eagle when they closed down the turnpike showing drawings of the various toll houses, and this does not show up. But we know darn well it has to be along that line because it's a Wummelsdorf trolley. But that particular toll house did not show up. And there's no doubt about that, that was a toll house. You can even see the gate going up there with the lady standing right next to it. Tony. Let's take a little break and Tony, tell us about the calendar for the Amity Heritage Society.
Okay, well, I was originally going to be coming on the show for a sales promotion for our calendars, but in recent hours I learned that we are pretty much sold out. This is our 2017 Photographic Treasures of the Past old photo calendar for Amity Heritage Society. And they sell for $10. And as of now, the only place you might be able to get them is Boyer's Store in Amityville, Star Books in Douglasville, Daniel Boone Homestead in Exeter Township, and Levin Good Flowers in Amity Township on 562.
I copied beginning with the front cover and going into December. But obviously, this computer decided it was going to scramble all the pictures.
Right.
So we're actually, let's see, what month are we looking at there?
That is...
The caption itself says, Raymond and Florence Airgood out for an autumn carriage ride along the Manitowney Creek. That's an interesting picture. I lightened the carriage a little bit, so that hopefully, yeah, that shows up well in the screen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that appears in May.
That's May. Okay, let's see what comes next. This is a particularly interesting one. This is a view of the covered bridge on Blacksmith Road. Interesting story about that. When they were tearing that down, one of the workers was killed by a board that sort of sprung loose and knocked him down and killed him. So they got him to the hospital, he was gone. You go to that site today, and you travel that modern road, and you have no idea that there was ever a covered bridge on that road. It's a nice straight road almost all the way through, a modern cement road, and no evidence whatever of a bridge ever having been there. But that was the bridge on Blacksmith Road. That connects the intersection at Amityville. There where the Weavertown Road sort of joins the regular road through the town, and then it goes back to, do you turn left on Leavengood? From the Boyertown Pike. You go down the Boyertown Pike, and I think it says it Leavengood Road. No, is it labeled Blacksmith Road? But it takes you right over to Weavertown.
Blacksmith, I think, takes you over to Earlville.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
You're right, near the hotel. Yeah, that's a big surprise, at least it was to me, because I've been to that site, and the current book has a picture in it of during the dismantling of the bridge, and a story about the fellow who lost his life with a board that went the wrong way. Holding her Steve teddy bear, Eleanor Allison is standing in front of her home on Weavertown Road. The original Brumfeldville post office, Brumfeldville was the post office for Weavertown, is pictured in the background. Now, what I'm looking at there on the upper right, I think that might have been the old hotel at one time. It wasn't the post office, that little building on the far left.
I'm not sure. Could be. I'm not sure.
I think they took that away a couple of years ago because there's an empty lot when you drive by there today. But anyhow, it says, note the highly ornate iron fence along the road. That would be at Weavertown. Look at our little Steve teddy bear. Funny story. When we moved to where we live now 54 years ago, we cleaned out the spring house. And there was a Steve teddy bear upstairs in the spring house that smelled very, very bad. They were stuffed with Excelsior, like wood shavings, and whatever bad smells there were in the spring house, that teddy bear absorbed them. It was really pretty bad. I threw it away. And I was told later that that was the wrong thing to do with a 1905 Steve teddy bear. I think that was the last picture in the calendar. A toast among friends on the John H. Geiger homestead located on Geiger Road. I don't know where that is.
If I remember right, I think this is a house that we just documented a couple years ago.
Really?
When the family sold the house out of the family.
Is that a stone house?
Yes.
Okay.
Although today it's pretty much remodeled.
Is it? This is a rather commodious structure. I was looking at that last night. Built in 1862 by William Airgood and Franklin Rhodes, this house on Blacksmith Road, was Amityville's first duplex. Catherine Airgood, who took this and many of the pictures in the calendar, was born and reared on the right half. Notice that there's an L out the back. That's a big building. I guess that's still pretty much the same.
I think so. I know it's there.
Here we have built by Dr. Reuben Rhodes in the 1860s. This stately Victorian sits on the foundation of the original store in the village of New Storeville, the old name for Amityville. Interesting, the old name was New Storeville, later Amityville, and the post office was Atoll, had three names. Located at the intersection of Old Airport Road and Route 662, this site is shown on a 1777 British spy map. Wasn't the store on the left side of this picture? It would be Boyer's store today,
right,
in Amityville.
Yeah, that would be across the...
would be across the street, right, on the left-hand side. Pennsylvania Railroad steam locomotive passing through Douglasville Station on March the 19th, 1938. Built in 1922, the bridge in the background is present-day River Bridge Road.
That's the one they just replaced.
Yeah, they just replaced that bridge, right. Douglasville Station,
is that
of course.
That's the one I was talking about near Farmer.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Yellow House Baseball Club was, let me see. The Yellow House Baseball Club were Berks County champions in 1922. Now, this should be of interest to some of the people viewing, because a lot of those people, I'm sure, have grandchildren and great-grandchildren by this time. Back row, left to right, is Fat Scherer, Tuck Horner, everybody had a nickname, Tuck Horner, Dewey Horner, Charlie Willman, Pop Wenzel, Pete Stranahan, and umpire Frank Hauser. Front row left to right, Harold Shetley, Dutch Nestor, Butcher, John Goulden, who was the manager, Jack Fulmer, Danny Harp, and Louis Ludwig. It's interesting when you look at these old baseball pictures, how long some of those bats were.
Right.
must have been a bit unwieldy. I read a picture in one of the books years back of baseball team in Stalsburg taken in the 1800s. That equipment really looked different from anything you'd see today. After the St. Paul's Union Church was destroyed by a tornado in 1922, the bell pulled from the rubble and served as a rallying point. The bell was pulled from the rubble and served as a rallying point. Determined to put it back up on top of the new church, fundraising began immediately. And I was always amazed that they made penny postcards to sell to rebuild the church.
Right.
But how many penny postcards must you sell to rebuild the church? I was trying to read that note on top of it.
It has hot dogs and other refreshments in the basement.
Aha. Uh-huh. That supplemented the postcard sales. This was a very interesting picture as far as I'm concerned, this one that you see on the screen now. There are pictures that have been published that show just the front part of this building. I have never seen the back part of that building. That was a revelation to me. And there you see on the far left, there's a truck out front. That was a building that was used to store things for the auction that they used to hold down at the Amity House Hotel. It says Bill Hess purchased the overall factory in Amityville from Charles S. Rhodes in 1938 and converted it into a feed mill. I never saw that picture before. So I said, I've seen photographs of just the front part of that, and that part out the back, the L, I've just never seen before. Gone today, the Slam White building was located at the corner of Weavertown and Old Airport Roads. That to me was the most interesting picture on the calendar, because that's a rare one. It didn't look like that all that long. That was short-lived. Newlyweds in 1917. Charles Gallagher and Irene Moyer posed for the camera before heading to the waiting carriage in the background.
Looks like Charlie Chaplin.
Nothing like having a groom with a big cigar.
Sort of looks like Charlie Chaplin, don't
it? Yeah, he does.
Mm-hmm. This is Ash Herner proudly showing off his horse. Located at the intersection of 662 and Weavertown Road, the Herner family owned this farm for 75 years before selling it to Butch and Harriet Boyer in 1963. Well, Butch Boyer had the store. I guess, does he still have it? I'm not sure. Route 662 is just behind them, and the buildings in the far background are on Blacksmith Road. Okay, I can picture that. This is a nice picture. I remember that that hotel very well, and what they did to it was a crime and a half. The Amity House Hotel that sat on Old Airport Road and 662 was a popular tavern patronized by local residents for 150 years. The first 75, they arrived by horse and carriage, and the second 75 by automobile. Here, the Tin Lizzie shows a time of transition. Notice the wooden hand pump on the right side of the photograph. Ken Nichols had that hotel, I guess, but it was at the time that it burned. It was Ken Nichols' Amity House, and then the hotel burned. It stood empty for a long, long time. They were going to restore it. Some fellows got together, and I don't know what they did, but eventually they tore it down. It was never rebuilt. That stood empty, I bet you, at least a decade. I believe we're back to the beginning. Yes, I think we've done it backwards. I'm not sure. Anyhow, the Yellow House Hotel had those. Had they sold them all at the Yellow House Hotel?
Yes, they did.
They did.
And I do want to thank, other than the ones I mentioned before, the Manitowney Creek Winery, the historic Britton Lodge, the Yellow House Hotel, and the Boone Area Library for selling these for us.
I'm glad that they've gone well this year. There's some neat pictures in there.
Yeah.
Again, it sells for $10, correct?
Right.
How many do they have printed?
We usually had 200 printed each year. So next year we might have 300. I don't know.
Oh, they really are out of control. This is the Bartow Depot. The Colebrookdale Railroad ran from Pottstown up to Boyertown. From Boyertown, it went northward up to Bartow, the end of the line. You can even see the trolley tracks there in that color picture in the foreground. A number of years ago, barely see the thing. It was so overgrown with trees and shrubs and all kinds of vines. That is the train station at Bartow. It's at the end of the line, and it was right across from the Bartow Hotel, which is still a going concern. At least it was the last time I went by there. Today, the Colebrookdale line begins at Boyertown and goes southward down to Pottstown. I haven't had this one handy. The American House Hotel. You might remember that in Hamburg they tried to promote that rather considerably a number of years ago. Yeah, I don't see anything happening today. I'm not sure what is happening there at the present time, but I know that there was a big push during the ownership of one of the fellows in more recent times to put this back on the map, but I'm not sure that worked too well. Maybe someone from Hamburg can let us know what's happening there. Do you recognize that? I think the year is 1917. That's the Reading Fair. Notice all the Model Ts that you see there in the foreground and the background. There are two pictures that were taken the same day by the same photographer of the opening of the Reading Fair. That's a picture that I had never seen before. In the latest passing scene book, I have a picture in there. It was labeled the new Quaker Meeting House in Reading. That building, of course, still stands. This picture was taken in late 1868, which is when the building was erected. In the background on the left-hand side, you see what used to be the parsonage for Trinity Lutheran Church. Today, I think it's an office for Trinity Lutheran Church. That building stands along North 6th Street between Washington and Walnut on the west side of the street. The building doesn't look all that much different today, but this picture was taken prior to the time that they put the shutters on the building. So this was a very early picture. At the same time that this picture was taken, the old meeting house, the earlier one from the 1700s, was fronted on Washington Street. It would have been, by today's standards, 412 Washington Street, was the old meeting house. They abandoned that because it was falling apart. It was a log structure. It was in bad shape. So they built this, and this was taken about, I'm guessing, late 1868. Very rare picture. Only one I've ever seen of it at that time period. Elm and Madison, very interesting how the Reading School District used to operate years ago with the schools. Typically, they would build a four-room building. And if the population in the general area increased, look at the left-hand side. That was the original Elm and Madison building. They needed more room, so they built on the right-hand side. Do you know how you can tell which is the newer side? Look at the windows. As time went on, there was a push for greater illumination in the classroom. So the old building had the windows, as you see, spaced that way. And on the new building, the windows were banked side by side. And then what happened later on, they needed more space. They built a building right on the corner where the parking lot is today for this building on 4th Street. And that building was doubled in size. So they actually had three enlargements over the original building that sat on that corner. This building is in terrible shape today. The last thing I heard was about this building that they're going to tear it down, and also with the old Arnold Bakery that was next door, they're going to tear all of that down and I think put in some housing units.
Where's that located at?
Elm and Madison. Well, that building is back there, is on Madison, and it's between 4th and Madison at Elm. Elm would be on the left-hand side of that. It's a shame for that building. But it's very interesting. And what I found also interesting is if they would have two buildings on the same site, each building had its own principal. There was one section in the city of Reading, Mulberry and Green. There were three buildings on that same site many years ago, and all three buildings had their own principal, which is very strange. This, I just happened to have my files and I threw it in. The gallows all ready for the execution of Mr. Gans. Mr. Gans was naughty to some woman and she died, and there was a trial, and he was the last person hanged in the prison yard in the old prison up in City Park. A little bit of a gory story. I wrote about the old prison in City Park for the Reading Eagle. I did it three sections in three parts about City Park, what was there years back, and I wrote about the prison. And in the article I mentioned about the last execution was up there in that prison yard, and by that time you could no longer watch. Earlier on, people used to come out in droves to watch the execution, but by 1902 they weren't doing that anymore. I wrote about that, my phone rang. And I answered the phone, and the woman said, "Mr. Miser, my daddy was the sheriff's assistant at that hanging." I said, "Really?" She said, "Yes." She said, "You know, I have the bloody rope in the cellar. Would you like it?" I mentioned it to Gloria, and she didn't think it was a good idea at all. So I very politely declined her offer. And I've often wondered what happened to that bloody rope that was in the cellar of the woman who telephoned me. The picture was taken in 1900, too. Every once in a while, I get I get phone calls about supposedly a cemetery on Washington Street. And the answer is, there was a cemetery on Washington Street. Years ago, I went to that site before they tore down. There you see an inset of the old church. The caption says, Lucy Lee Flippin points to the location of a narrow strip, now macadamized over, where a single marked burial remained behind the church until World War I. This was the Washington Street Presbyterian Church at 1031 Washington Street. Today, there's a parking lot. When you go down Washington Street, on the right-hand side, there's a parking lot. And you'll see that back part of that house. You can see that from the parking lot. But the church was there. It was in very bad shape at the time that it was torn down. And they had burials in that site, which is now macadamized over it. It said that there were 9 marked burials remaining in 1909. Those that were legible read as following. Susan, wife of George Dillon, born 1814, died 1864. Sarah, wife of Reverend Samuel Underhill, he was a pastor there, born April the 5th, 1815, died 1875, age 60. And Margaret Dillon, Catherine, and Catherine Williams, they were on that cemetery. Now, supposedly, some of the burials were removed to Charles Evans Cemetery, and the later burials of the people who attended that church were made over at Charles Evans Cemetery. But they did not move all the burials. They were there, and when the church was torn down, they just macadamized over everything, including the burial ground. Are they still there? Yep. Well, we're back in Penn Street. four people from the Reading Eagle were kind enough to put on those sandwich boards and to walk down Penn Street for the parade. Again, you can see there in the background how many people really turned out for that. It was rather impressive, I thought. We didn't march in the parade. We sat in the car and went down Penn Street in the Reading Eagle car to observe what was going on. Yeah, look at that crowd. That to me was astounding because I hadn't seen a crowd like that on Penn Street for a parade for years. You know what? I think that's just about it, unless something happened. I think there were some pictures that didn't show up. But anyhow, tell us about the Amity Heritage Society. What's going on there these days? What project is in the works, other than that building up in?
Right, that's still an ongoing process, the Peter Jones House. Within the past year, we've been busy with we took down a stone house in Amity Township that was under new ownership, and the owners just wanted to raise it. So we went in there to save parts of the building to use in the 1773 Peter Jones house. So we were busy with that. We were also busy with the rebuilding of the Peter Jones house over the summer. And last winter, we took down the Sexton House for the Schwarzwald Church that you pretty much know of.
Yes, my church.
So this past year, we've been pretty busy.
How far have they gotten with the Peter Jones House?
We do have the stonework up to the top of the first floor level.
Oh, dear. And what's going to be the use for that building when it's completed?
It's going to be a historic and cultural center.
Is that for what group?
It's going to be between us, and we're trying to get a group up in that area to also use it too. Like either a Hawk Mountain or to give presentations. And
is that anywhere near Trexler?
It's in the village of, it is in Trexler. I keep thinking of Albany, but it's in Trexler.
It's in Trexler.
Right outside of Albany.
Interesting little building, yeah. Trexler used, there was a big log cabin up there that's very impressive. It was originally a tavern, and it's been a house for a number of years.
That's currently for sale.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh.
The last I was up there, there was a for sale sign in front of it.
Hmm. Interesting. I'm looking at a couple of pictures in the passing scene book, and there's one thing that I'd like to bring to your attention that I found absolutely amazing. I don't know whether you could do anything with this on this side or not. Okay, well, that's not too bad. Okay, last New Year's Eve, I went for a ride. My daughter, my stepdaughter, and I went for a ride, and it was going through Fleetwood. And on South Richmond Street in Fleetwood, I saw this hedge. I don't know how well it shows up on TV, but I saw this hedge, and it was actually a showstopper. I got out of the car, took pictures. I have never seen a hedge like that in my life. It is absolutely perfectly straight, no dead spots, absolute perfection. I wondered when I got there, how you maintain something like that, which is living. I remember I took care of a hedge when I was a kid, and my hedge never looked anything at all like that. That is absolutely perfectly straight, like as though they had used surveyor's instruments to trim
like
that thing.
Wall.
Yeah, it looks like a wall. It is absolutely amazing. On South Richmond Street, I think it's at 212. Yeah, really quite a surprise. There are two pages in here dedicated to one of our dearest friends, Ruth Hartman, either the lady, the queen of baseball town, or the sheep lady. She won prizes and awards all over the place in the state and elsewhere for the sheep that she raised. She just loved those sheep. And when they would go for a show, they were absolutely gorgeous animals. She had them all groomed so beautifully. There on the right-hand side, the upper inset, you see Ruth showing her baseball card. She played for a girls team way back when, and she had a baseball card of which she was very, very proud. And unfortunately, some of you people might remember what happened to Ruth. Gloria and I had lunch with her at the Ole Turnpike Dairy. We were at the post office then, and she left and we left, and I didn't realize that she went down the Ole Turnpike, I guess to 662, and a deer ran in front of the car and it was hit. She was very much upset, jumped out of the car to see what she could do for the deer, and didn't have the car in park, and it ran over her. She was trapped under the car. It was a terrible way to go. All because she was so concerned about the animals. But that's Ruth Hartman, who is remembered for her sheep, for her baseball playing, and just being one incredible person. She worried about those sheep. She was very well advanced in age when she passed away. I remember her saying, "George, I don't know how much longer I can do this," because she would have to help deliver some of those sheep. And it was getting to the point, that's a big animal. And to lift those things around and do what she had to do was really something of a trial. But anyhow, Ruth Hartman. Now, this is in your neck of the woods.
Yep.
In the color section. You want to tell them where this is?
That's in St. Gabriel's Cemetery in Douglasville. That's Sandrew Robinson's grave, the founder of Robinson Township.
And where is that stone?
The closest one to the railroad tracks.
That's right. You park your car along the highway at the early St. Gabriel's Church. You walk straight back towards the railroad. I think there's a poem on the other side, but remove from noise and care the silent spot I chose when death should take my days, when death should take my, what is it, life
You used to have it memorized.
I used to have it memorized, you're right. I'm not feeling it. Anyhow, what happened was removed, yeah, from this the silent spot I chose when death should end my years to take sweet repose. Here in this silent spot, my ashes must remain. My Savior shall me keep and raise me up again. He didn't realize that in 1833, they were going to run the main line of the Reading Railroad very, very close to his burial ground, and he gets shaken a whole lot during the course of every given day. On the right-hand side is the... is the footstone. Notice the skull. Beneath it, the hourglass, reminding about the sands of time keep going whether you like it or not. You have the crossbones beneath, and below is the cheery admonition, remember death. On the front, here lieth the body of Andrew Robeson. Here lieth the body of Andrew Robeson, who died February the 19th, 1719-20. That 1719-20 refers to the double dating that they used to have between the Gregorian calendar and the Julian calendar. He died at the age of 66. The remarkable thing is, well, two things. Number one, that was a good age for that time period. And number two, those are a type of green granite. Those stones have weathered very, very little over the years. It's amazing that they're still there in that condition.
Can I add something tonight?
Sure.
Before St. Gabriel Cemetery, my friend Connie Sadowski, his great-great-grandfather was Anthony Sadowski, who was a pioneer, just like Conrad Weiser in this area, and he's buried in that cemetery.
There's a marker to his memory.
Is there a marker there now? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. We thank you folks for staying with us this evening under rather trying circumstances, I'm afraid. So on behalf of Larry Soltys, Anthony Mattassa, and myself, George M. Eisner IX, we thank you for your indulgence and for watching. Thank you. Good night.
The Passing Scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.,